with the one and only Bruce Kulick back here in Australia to do some shows. How are you doing?
Wonderful. It's, you know, pretty exhausting. Pretty exhausting.
Yeah, you've got a killer schedule.
Yeah, 3 gigs in a row, and I flew over and rehearsed with the guys. But I got a terrific Australian band, and it's wonderful to be here. You know how I feel about my Down Under fans. So,
your adopted country, you know we love you. And this is the second time you've been here this year.
Yeah, I mean, the other time, of course, was sponsored by Alan's, you know, Music Chain, and that's a little different than coming out here and playing some of the venues and rocking with a real band. But I love them both. Anything that's got a guitar or a girl in my hand, I'm very comfortable with.
They were fantastic clinics, too.
Thank you. I really enjoyed that. Now, unfortunately, I know I was talking that I could release or sell my record at these, you know, gigs, but I got a real record deal around the world, actually, for it. And because
fantastic.
Of that, I thank you. I need to wait. January 29th is the release date in
this
country.
Moved up from February. Yeah. Oh, we get it earlier than February
16th.
Well,
you get it, and now it moved up from February 16th in North America to February 2nd. Because in North America, it needs to be on a Tuesday.
We
you guys can
first.
Do it on a Friday, yeah. But only by a few days, so it's not a big deal anymore.
So tell us all about BK3. It's killer. I've heard some of the tracks. It's unbelievable.
Well, I'm really excited. Obviously, it took a long time, and I meant to make something that was really special and different. And I met a good friend of mine who wound up producing it for me, who wanted to kick my ass and prove that we can make our own revenge record, kind of, you know. And then once Gene and his
sure
son
did.
Nick got involved, and then, of course, Karabi, Steve Lukather did an instrument. The only
How
instrumental
awesome
track.
Is that yeah. instrumental?
Yeah. And then it just really, really came together over a very long period of time because of me working and traveling and all. I work with Grand Funk Railroad in America, and that keeps me busy for about
you
a third
are
of the
very
year.
Very busy,
you know.
In demand.
I like to stay busy. Yes, yes. But the you know, 2010. I'm really looking forward to. You know, it's going to be really exciting. This is like kind of the prequel, you know what I mean? And then who knows what's going to happen, but I'm just really thrilled. I can't wait
for
the fans.
We're going to want you back as soon as it's released.
Yes, 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 and we'll work that out, but I just can't wait for everybody to hear all, you know, all the tracks. You know, it's going to be great.
Fantastic. Well, the lucky people here tonight can buy the EP.
Yeah, actually, in fact, the inversion of the EP, because, again, I couldn't sell. I didn't want to sell the same one I had back in April, but I offered one other song, the one that Tobias Sammet sings from Ed Guy, who's a terrific singer, and Eric Singer plays drums on that track.
That's
and
a
then
great
I,
track.
And then I put, and again, this thing I'm offering really, this is almost like, I'm sorry I can't sell the real record, so for $5 you can go home with these three songs. One of them's from BK3, the other two are rare kind of union tracks, okay? Song I sang for the Japanese market, and then one from the DVD that was never released, really. It was like a bonus demo.
So a must-have anyway.
Yeah, I think so, especially for $5. And you get a sticker with it, a BK3 sticker, you know.
Jeez, that's
but
a
I
bargain.
Feel really bad because my posters, which are so lovely, they say, you know, exclusive, you know, you can buy BK3 here. But all the fans, I've been explaining it all the dates, and they really do understand the fact that I've moved on to having the record company support, in which case you can't sell it at the gigs or the back of your car, you know, before, you know, it's really released. So,
but you can go to your website and hear samples.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You can hear, you know, there's stuff out there. There's like 6 things. There's a couple of the complete songs, and then there's some the Gene song you could hear some of. Yeah, absolutely. It's out there. But again, I'm hoping everybody orders or goes to the record shop and supports it. The packaging's terrific. You're going to love it. So just, I think it's a record you're going to have to, it's a must have.
Absolutely. It sounds fantastic. I love it. And go and check out the New Look website and hear the tracks. I like the New Look.
Yeah, yeah. I needed to.
It doesn't hurt my eyes anymore.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Before it was like a grid-like blue thing, blue being my color. But once I had all this new art direction stuff for my, you know, actual CD packaging, I got another guy involved. My web people did it, in who are in America, but I had a little bit of help from a guy that the art director knew, and all of a sudden the page was just like, oh my God, you know. It's kind of like that poster comes to life on the site. And of course everybody knows many pictures, and there'll be pictures of me with this Australian trip, of course. In fact, we'll take a picture for that.
Oh, okay. Awesome,
I'll grab
great.
One with my camera, for sure.
Now, you have just done Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp again.
Yes.
Please explain to everyone at home who does not know what that is. It is awesome.
I mean, it's for anybody who really thinks they can play. Even if you don't play, it's okay to come. But it you get to actually be in a band. You get to learn what it is to rehearse and be led by people like myself as counselors and a lot of other, you know, really well-known musicians that you'd want to hang around. Then we have the big special guests come in, like Meat Loaf or John Anderson from Yes, or Jack Bruce if it's in London, or, you know, it's a really amazing. Bill Wyman was there. I mean, Paul Stanley has done it. Ace just did it recently, too. And it's like, the guy there has been doing a 3 and a 5 day. I could only do the 5 day this year, and that was crazy enough. But it's very rewarding. I really enjoy doing it. And, it is pricey, but it's worth it. It's kind of like going off to like football camp or something, you know what I mean? Or, you know, when you're fantasy camp or whatever. That's what it is, except it's living and breathing rock and roll. In the end, you not only record at a famous studio, you wind up on stage at a famous venue in L.A. So it's very cool, very cool.
Fantastic. Okay, your fantasy lineup.
Oh, Paul McCartney would be there.
Awesome.
Paul Rodgers would be there, you know. Maybe Dave Grohl on drums. You know, I mean, you know, some of the people that I love are not with us anymore, like John Lennon and Jimi Hendrix, of course. But that's a crux of a good band right there, I think I mentioned.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Now, because you've done the Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, you know there's the rumors that there's going to be the Bruce and Ace tour.
Well, you know, look.
How awesome would that be?
Yeah, I mean, anything's possible. But and it was really fun. I actually interviewed him at the last camp. It was kind of interesting. But I don't have any firm details about anything. It's something that, you know, people can obviously rumor about because it would make sense in a way. But I don't know. I would love to do it, but I just don't know if it's going to happen.
If you do, you must bring it here.
Yeah, I would love to. And I know he's going to be down here in February. Make sure you come out to see him. You know.
Absolutely. Now, he's doing meet and greets. You're doing meet and greets after the show, aren't you?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you do that everywhere?
I try to. Obviously, if there was 1,000 people there, it's hard, okay? We don't have 1,000 tonight, so I think I'll be able to meet and greet most of them, you know.
You're not going to sacrifice the show for the 1,000 people.
No, exactly.
Fair enough. You know. Now, you've got some killer tracks on the set list. I've had a sneak peek.
Sure.
How did you go about putting it together this time?
I actually let Paul, my buddy Paul Drennan, who's part of the band, the other guitar player who takes care of me.
He has very good taste in Kiss
music.
Yeah,
and he's a Kiss freak, so I just said, look, show me what you got, and we discussed it on the phone about a month before I came out, so he gave it to the other guys to listen to, but it's really a good list, and it's very much filling that gap of what Kiss hasn't been doing, you know, because there is that long era that I've been involved in that I think they ignore too much.
There is some gems
that should
not be overlooked.
Right, and I don't understand completely why they do it, but since they don't, it only makes it better for me to do it for the fans, so I'm having fun with some of those rather Kiss non-makeup chestnuts, as I call them.
Yeah, the gold era, golden era of Kiss non-makeup. Now, you've gone and seen Kiss recently. How is it taking a step back and having a look at them doing
that? Well, they completely rolled out the red carpet for me, so that was wonderful. And I saw them with, I remember I saw them when they opened for Aerosmith, okay, and that was only Tommy, though, not Eric. So I'd never seen actually Eric Singer, who's, of course, we do the
ESP thing.
One
of your drummers.
Yeah. And we're really good friends. And so that was really trippy to see them. And I tell you, they're very busy when it comes to getting ready for a show because they do a lot of press and then they do their platinum package, meet and greet, and the whole thing. So I got there early enough, I could sound check, so it was a lot of fun.